Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Raphael, Painter in Rome, a novel by Stephanie Storey. Narrated by P.J. Ochlan. Prologue. Rome, March 1520.
Why does Michelangelo always get to be the hero? A struggling sculptor, not trained in the art of fresco, forced by a temperamental pope to abandon his precious marble and paint a wretched ceiling, overcomes agony and obstacles to create a divine masterpiece. Sì, certo, you're moved by the story. I'm moved by it. But you don't honestly believe that he painted that ceiling while lying on his back, do you? How would he crawl in and out, his body only an arm length from the ceiling, without smearing the paint all the time? And how would he have moved? Wriggled about on his shoulder blades and hindquarters? Perhaps once or twice when he was up against a particularly steep curve of a spandrel, he had no choice but to lie on his back for a few moments. But let's bury the myth right now. Michelangelo painted, like the rest of us, standing up. Don't believe me? Look at his own drawings. He sketched himself painting that ceiling, head tilted back, arms stretching overhead, standing on his feet. So no, Michelangelo was not some subjugated hero forced to lie on his back by an intransigent pope. I'm not angry with him for the story. I only wish I'd thought of it. And tell me, per favore, that you don't believe that he hates to paint. Yes, he repeats the lie often as the Nicene Creed, but that doesn't make it true. During the 4 years when he was painting the Sistine, not carving any marble at all, he still insisted on signing his letters, Michelangelo, sculptor in Rome, as though he hates to paint so much that he's incapable of calling himself a painter. But have you ever walked into the Sistine on a quiet Tuesday morning and looked up at those colors? Santa Madonna, those colors! Were you moved to tears too? Now tell me that he could have painted such a thing while hating it. Is that what you tell your children? Find something you hate, force yourself to do it, and ecco, a masterpiece. I know what people say about me. They say that Raphael Santi of Urbino is the ideal courtier. Polite, generous, humble. They say I was born with such happy countenance that nothing ruffles me. They say my good looks reflect the beauty on the inside. They say my talent comes easily. They say everything comes easily. But don't strip me of my humanity because I'm good at playing a part. You do it too, I'll wager. Put on a smile sometimes, even when you're feeling foul. So don't deny me those same basic human talents. In real life, no one could be as generous and loyal and charming as I pretend to be. No one. You imagine me, if you imagine me at all, the way he describes me, don't you? Standing in the background, easy to forget, an easy rival to vanquish. When I look back on those years, I picture the events the way he tells them too. Him in the center, me in the corner. Maria Vergine! That's what I do, isn't it? All he does is make himself the hero of his own story. Can I blame him for that? But why do I insist on making him the hero of mine? How can I expect anyone else to say I'm the greatest painter in history, if I can't say so myself? Is there a version where I get to be the hero? Or does he end the victor every time? Chapter 1. February 7th, 1497. Florence. The first time I saw Michelangelo, I don't remember seeing him, but he swears that we saw each other, and we've been round and round about this so many times that I don't want to argue about it anymore. So, if you'll do me a kindness, somewhere during this next part, insert his face and, if you get the chance, tell him that's how I remember it, because the only face that I recall clearly from that night is the face of that woman in that portrait, landing in that fire. She was painted in profile with wavy umber hair, tied up in blue ribbons. Her dress was the color of opals, lime white softened with hints of indigo and red ochre. She was young, alluring, and so graceful. "Is that a Botticelli?" I asked. "Andiamo," Perugino said, voice so thick with fear that I would have painted it flat black. "Why are they burning it?" "Now, we have to go. Now, I'm going to save it." I pulled my arm free and slipped through the crowd. I was only 14, but already knew that there was no way to bring a thing back once it was destroyed. It was crowded in Florence's Piazza della Signoria that night. As I approached the fire, I had to strain to see the top of the flames, yellow with sparks of cinnabar, casting a devilish halo across the night sky. A line of men and women approached the bonfire, holding armfuls of... what? It was too smoky to see well. But once they stepped up to the flames, I could see a man tossing a lute into the fire, a boy throwing in a deck of playing cards, and a woman adding a pile of embroidered wool dresses. What would keep her warm come winter? After sacrificing, they dropped to their knees, raised their arms, and wailed as though they could, somehow, throw their voices into the fire too.
"Burn your mirrors, your dresses, your paintings, your books!"
A grim voice called over the crowd.
"If you don't repent, this city shall be no more than a well of blood, a den of thieves, a house of poverty!"
Standing atop a platform next to the bonfire was, did you guess, Fra Girolamo Savonarola. Mi dispiace. That name makes a lot of people uneasy. If you don't like it, I won't repeat it again. I promise. Did you ever visit Florence during that madman friar's rule? Ah, you missed quite a spectacle. That night, he was wearing dark robes with a heavy hood pulled low over his forehead, shadowing deep-set eyes, long nose, angular cheeks. He waved his arms like a conductor and spoke in a melodious rhythm.
"If we do not cleanse ourselves of sin, the sword of the Lord will come down upon us all, quickly and soon."
I pressed my hands over my ears to keep from being entranced and pushed toward the flames. Where was that Botticelli? There! The wood panel looked thick and hard like oak. That was good, but flames were clawing at the wood, digging ragged caves of orange cinder around the edges. I reached for the portrait. Flames tickled my fingers. I yanked back. Burned arm hair smells a lot like dead ermine.
"The line for atonement is there, son," a woman said, face smudged with ash.
"I'm not here to..." Thankfully, I swallowed the word atone and instead said, "I don't have anything to give." I turned back to the Botticelli. A crack filled with bubbling orange cinder was splitting the portrait in two.
"But your pictures!"
The woman grabbed the strap of my traveling bag.
"These are nothing," I said,
making my voice calm as creamy white brushed flat on treated wood.
"Only crude drawings. Sinner!"
I swear that woman's tongue flicked out, purple and forked like a snake. All right. Perhaps that was only my imagination, but that's how I remember it, so that's the way I tell it. In that moment, oh, how I regretted coming to Florence. I'd lived most of my life in Urbino. Have you been? Yes, it's remote. A walled city on the eastern edge of the Apennines. Takes several days to get there, but worth the trip. terraced hills, cypress trees, Roman ruins. After a winter snow, the sky turns lavender with a little extra blue, ultramarine, not azurite, and the buildings glow in shades of copper, rust, and ale. When you visit, don't miss the Ducal Palace. With its bell tower and dome prominently positioned high upon the hill, it looks more like a church than a palace, which is appropriate, because in many ways our court is our religion. When you think of the peninsula's great courts, you think of Milan, Venice, and Ferrara, don't you? Va bene. But don't forget Urbino. Our court was and still is a paragon of poetry, fashion, and jousting of swords and words alike. It's also the court where my father served. Giovanni Santi spent his days making pretty pictures for the Duke, and his nights teaching me to make pretty pictures of my own. Before I could walk, I used to sit atop his feet as he swayed back and forth while painting. I learned the rhythm of the paint through those feet. What I remember most about my father's death was his paintbrush. It wasn't a family heirloom. The Duke hadn't bestowed it during some special ceremony. My father hadn't made it. He never made his own brushes. He'd probably picked it up at some market or another. It had a long wooden handle, spattered with dried specks of indigo and lead tin yellow. The bristles were extra long horsehair and caked with malachite green. The apothecary tried to take that brush from his hand, but my father wouldn't let go. A nun nudged me into the room. It smelled of poppies, earwax, and blood. The scents of men trying to cure things that can't be cured. The windows were covered with red velvet curtains. Red like ochre, not orange like vermilion. I wondered, why shut out the sun if you're only going to light so many candles? The room was crowded, not only with doctors and nuns, but furniture. My mother had crammed too many tables, chairs, and chests into the house, and my father hadn't removed a single piece, not even after she died. 3 years before, when my mother and sister got sick, I hadn't known what the word deathbed meant. But by age 11, I was old enough to understand.
You weren't born on Good Friday for nothing, my father said, taking my fingers in the same hand as the paintbrush. The wooden handle dug into my flesh. God wouldn't have blessed you with such charm and talent unless you were destined to rise. I looked at my shoes. They were worn leather, splattered with blue paint. There was a hole over my left toe. I regretted not putting on a fresh pair. My father whispered, "Prometimi." My mother had said the same. Promise me you'll take care of your father. I replied to him the same way I'd replied to her. Anything. Promise me you'll never give up the paint. But I want to go with you. I resented that my voice cracked like a boy's. You must stay, Rafa. Stay and become the greatest painter in the world. The greatest painter in history. Giovanni, Evangelista da Pian di Meleto, my father's most trusted assistant, tall and stout as a bell tower, said from the opposite side of the bed. The boy doesn't need that now. Anything less, my son, will be a disappointment to God and to me. Your father is delirious, a priest whispered. Time for childhood is over,
My father's eyes fluttered.
Promettimi!
I'd failed my mother's promise. I hadn't taken good enough care of my father. I wouldn't fail this one. I replied, I promise.
Sì,
he said to Evangelista.
I told you this wouldn't destroy him.
He turned back to me.
So, my son, you have plenty of work to do. For I've given you a job, so you must do it. There will be no time for grief. You will have to work hard, but never with sadness or anger. God has given you life, so you must embrace it. Beauty springs from joy. If you remember that, you'll keep your promise to me. And keep your promise. You must.
I wish death were like an altarpiece, contained in a single scene. Don't you? Instead, it's panel after panel after panel. If I could repaint the moment of death, here's what I'd choose. A father limp in bed, hand open and empty, nuns raising arms in prayer, and a boy, off to the side, crouching at the foot of an old cabinet, to pick up off the floor a long-handled, long-bristled paintbrush. That's how death should come, shouldn't it? The night my father finally slipped into the great sea, I returned to his studio. My studio. His assistants had packed up their things and left. The maestro was dead. They had families to support. And a boy of 11 couldn't help. They'd taken everything. Jars of paint, stacks of panels, ropes, tarps, two studio chickens. All gone. The little they'd left was a mess. Empty bottles toppled over. Bristleless paintbrushes strewn across the floor. A three-legged chair leaning against an old wooden table. I looked for a bucket of water, but those were gone too. Kneeling in the doorway, I took my father's long-handled paintbrush out of my pocket. In real life, I'd pried that brush out of my father's rigid fingers as a priest tried to drag me away while I wept. Not an ideal scene at all. I dipped that brush into a puddle of muddy rainwater and scrubbed the bristles. I scrubbed and scrubbed, but still couldn't make the green tint disappear. At the funeral, a gracious affair for which I would still owe the Duke and Duchess a great debt, if they were still alive to accept it, I thanked the Duke of Urbino, Guidobaldo da Montefeltro, for gifting me with one of my father's best paintings, a virgin and child, beautifully framed. The next morning, the Duke sent me to apprentice for the greatest painter in our region, Pietro Perugino. My father had used mainly tempera paints for his panel pictures, but Perugino taught me to stop mixing pigments with egg and start mixing them with linseed oil instead. Perugino helped me master oil paints, the medium of the future, of the great Northerners, of Leonardo da Vinci. Tempera is thin. Oils are rich. Tempera dries fast, oils slow. Tempera relies on flat blocks of color, while oils live in shadow. I went to bed late, rose early, and mixed so many colors that my mortar and pestle began to wear thin. When I was 14, Perugino agreed to take me to Florence to study the masters. I thought I was so important, crossing those mountains on that slow 6-day ride. I'd heard the rumors that Florence had fallen on dark times. The Medici family had been the de facto rulers of Florence for
what, over 100 years? After they were exiled, someone had to fill the power vacancy. So in strode that madman friar. Whereas the Medici had preached the gospel of greed, that friar parabled poverty and the wrath of God. But I didn't take the warning seriously. No preacher, no matter how good, could preach a city like Florence out of its love of art. I was wrong, sì certo. Proof was that woman trying to wrench my sketchbook from my hands as flames wrapped around that Botticelli portrait. I was running out of time to save it. So I looked up at the woman and offered my best smile, the crooked one where only one of my dimples shows, and said, "These are devotional images, my lady. Madonnas, mainly."
"Madonnas?"
Several men crowded around. I felt like I was standing in the bottom of a well with walls made of strange followers of that madman friar.
What else would a boy draw?
I pulled out my sketchbook and riffled through the pages. I was telling the truth, sort of. It was a book of Madonnas, mostly. I stopped where I knew there were several pretty Madonnas in a row.
Nothing but drawings of the most perfect woman in the world.
"And nudes!" that woman cried, pulling a page out of the back. The drawing was a study of the pagan Greek goddess Aphrodite. Not exactly proper subject matter for such a religious gathering.
"That's how you draw a Madonna," I said, backing into a thick man blocking my escape. "You draw the natural body first and add clothes later."
"One way or another, those drawings are going in."
The woman grabbed my neck and pushed me toward the fire. If she made me burn my sketchbook, could I recreate the drawings inside? No. A drawing doesn't only capture a scene, but a particular moment in an artist's career. And that moment is always changing. As Leonardo said, it's like stepping into a river as the water rushes by. It's never the same river twice. All right, yes. Leonardo was paraphrasing Heraclitus, but so what if I prefer to credit the master from Vinci over a notoriously malcontent Greek? I glanced toward the Botticelli. Where is it? There. A glimmer of her pale face. I could still save it, but how many people were ahead of me in that line, waiting to throw their belongings into the flames? 15? 20? Why was the line moving so slowly? And why was the fire burning so hot? Smoke seeped into my nose and mouth. My eyes started to sting. At the sight of tears on a boy's cheek, the woman softened.
"Where are your parents?"
I turned my large, round eyes up. I knew that they would reflect the fire quite dramatically, and sighed.
"Both gone into the great sea, signora."
"Why?"
Her eyes filled with tears.
"You don't have anyone to show you better."
I shook my head. She took my face in her hands and said,
"Give your sinful things to God. Only then will he save you, save us all, in a sea of miracles."
Her face shone bright with faith. Those tears in her eyes were tears of hope. I felt sorry for her. The first time I saw that lump bulging in my father's stomach, I thought God had granted a miracle and turned my father into the first man to grow a baby. My father would birth that baby, which would, no doubt, be a girl, and grow up to be a mother with daughters of her own. My house would once again be filled with mothers and sisters. But that was before I discovered that God doesn't grant miracles, and a lump growing in a man's stomach is never a sign of life, but only a sign of sick. So I felt sorry for that lady, that follower of that madman friar, because she hadn't yet learned the truth that God doesn't grant miracles. And it's a painful thing to learn, isn't it?
Yes, yes,
I cried, throwing one arm in the air and rolling my eyes back into my head, just like that boy cured of demons in the Gospels.
I feel the Lord.
As the woman fell to her knees to thank God for leading me to salvation, she released my face. I stumbled backward and dropped to the ground among the forest of feet and legs.
Boy, the woman cried. Help that boy, he's fainted.
I darted through the undergrowth of legs and weeds of shadows, my sketchbook held tight to my chest. I pushed my way to the edge of the fire.
Where was the painting? A mirror, a stack of books, the lid of a harpsichord. There! Almost gone, but her face still intact. With my left hand, I could still paint without a left hand. I reached toward the flames, but the bonfire crinkled and one side collapsed. Ash blanketed me. I coughed and looked over at the Botticelli. Or rather, where it had once been. Now it was nothing but cinder. It didn't take long to find Perugino waiting at the edge of the piazza.
Where's the Botticelli? He asked.
I shook my head. He put his arm around my shoulders and hurried us out of the square. I knew I wasn't supposed to. Lot's wife, Sodom, salt and all. But I did look back. How many pieces of art were going up in flames that night? After my mother died, I'd found my father in his studio, adding gold leaf to a picture of the Holy Family. The rest of the court was mourning up at the palace. So I asked,
"What are you doing down here?"
And he replied,
"Painting the world as it should be, instead of as it is."
Looking back at the bonfire that night, I decided that's what I would do too. I wouldn't paint scenes of angst or wretchedness or violence. The world had enough of those. No, I would paint picture after picture of beauty. So much beauty that no fire could ever consume it all. And maybe, just maybe, if I painted enough, then the world would bend toward my pictures and become as perfect as it should be. And if I could paint so well that I bent the world, even if only a little, toward beauty, then I would keep my promise to my father. For I, Raphael Santi, would indeed be the greatest painter in all of history. Chapter 2. Summer, 1504. Città di Castello.
Raphael?
I heard her, yes, but pretended as if I didn't. I tugged both sleeves away from my hands, rolled my right wrist four times. Uno, due, tre, quattro. Dipped my brush into the paint, wiped the bristles twice on each side against the rim of the clay pot, and leaned in to add another touch of raw umber to my panel of the Three Graces.
Raphael!
I waved my hand as if shooing away a fly. My painting of the three nude female graces from Greek mythology dancing in a circle was my most graceful painting yet. Soft lines, glowing skin, curving bodies. But when I was 6 years old or so, while my mother and sister were up at the house readying the noontime meal, I was down in the studio, like always, with my father, when he told me,
"We're part of a competition, Rafa. A competition to reach perfection."
I was sitting on his paint-splattered stool as he leaned in, talking in an excited whisper. I leaned in too, as he delivered the secrets of his trade. My trade.
all painters, maestro to apprentice, know that it's possible to create a perfect painting. But guess what? His voice sounded so urgent that it made my heart tap the speed of vermilion. No one has done it yet. And do you know what that means? It means we might be the ones to get there first. Now, let's see if we've done it. He took me off the stool and led me toward his latest picture of the Holy Family. Joseph looking down on Mary, cradling baby Jesus. It was beautiful. All of my father's paintings were beautiful. But not perfect, my father sighed. Not yet. 15 years later, there I was, sitting in front of yet another painting. This time my painting, silently repeating, not perfect. Not yet. Rafa, are you the sort of person who can do 8 things at once? Painting, eating, squashing a bug with your heel, all while carrying on a conversation. Have you ever seen Leonardo da Vinci paint with one hand, play a lute with the other, all while dancing and telling a joke? I'm no juggler. If I'm focused on something, I focus only on it. The rest of the world fades away. I used to think that everyone was the same as me, but now I know better. Sometimes I wish we all functioned the same, so we didn't have to explain ourselves to one another. If we all acted the same, thought the same, were the same, then life would be simpler. Life as it should be, right? Rafa! I turned to face Tessa, standing in the doorway looking annoyed. She was a servant from the Duke's quarters in Urbino who'd come with me to keep my house in the Castello. I said, "You'll have poetry this evening, mia cara, but right now..." I turned back to my painting, tugged up both sleeves, rolled my wrist, uno, due, tre. "You said you were taking me to church today?" Her voice went up like a question. I stared blankly. Then, oh, I knocked over my tray. Persephone! How was I supposed to become the greatest painter if I couldn't even keep a tray steady? I scrambled to pick up my brushes and began reordering them from shortest to longest.
Rafa, per favore, amore. I know you're nervous.
I'm not nervous. Sì, certo, I was nervous. I was 21 years old, and after years of painting Madonna after Madonna after Madonna, I'd finally unveiled a work that had captured attention. And today, my former teacher, Perugino, was coming to view that work. Today I would find out, would he finally call me maestro or not? I placed the brushes back on the tray in a neat row. I straightened the first brush, then another and another. Tessa sighed.
Rafa, today is more important than...
I know how important today is, I said, straightening the last two brushes and crossing to the mirror. I tucked my hair behind both ears, ran my fingers across my eyebrows and checked my nose and mouth for dregs. Yes, people call me handsome. High forehead, oval eyes, strong jaw, the whole traditional look. But, as my mother always said, handsomeness without cleanliness is wasted. The town of Città di Castello had the same hills, same climate, same accents, same colors as Urbino. Living in a place that reminded me of home usually gave me comfort, but that day I couldn't quell my apprehension. As Tessa and I crossed town, I counted every step. Uno, due, tre, quattro. Uno, due, tre, quattro. But when we arrived at the Church of San Francesco, my foot landed on the top stair on a count of 3. There wasn't enough room to squeeze in another step, not even a small one. On a day as important as that, would you have entered on an ill-fated count of 3? Wait, I said, and turned to walk away from the door. Tessa exhaled.
Rafa.
Sevens are luckier than fours. I walked back toward the entrance.
Uno, due, tre, quattro, cinque, sei, sette. With the last step, I landed beside Tessa again. I took her hand. Andiamo.
Inside the old church of San Francesco, the morning light was warm and bright. Up ahead to the right, a group of men gathered around an ornate chapel. My heart thumped in the side of my neck. Was my teacher Perugino among them? As I started to hurry up the nave, Tessa admonished,
"Raffa, for holy's sake!"
Dutifully, I backed up, dipped my finger into the font of holy water, crossed myself, genuflected, and then stood to hurry down the aisle.
"Slow down!"
She took a ceremoniously long time blessing herself.
"Per favore!"
The longing in my voice finally moved her. She took my hand and let me lead her into the church. As we approached the group of men gathered around the altar, Tessa giggled. I shushed her.
She said, "Rafa, let me be excited."
But I wasn't listening. I was scanning faces. Was he there? There? No. No, where? Finally, a man turned. He had the ruddy cheeks, ropey brown hair, and determined frown of a face I knew well. Pietro Perugino. He'd come. I'd grown taller and into my shoulders since I'd seen him last, but still felt like a child when he said, "Raffaello Santi of Urbino." "Maestro Perugino." I released Tessa's hand and bowed. "Whatever successes I have, the credit goes to you." I breathed slowly. Would he praise me or dismiss me? Would he call me master? Would he hand me the keys to his studio, like Christ giving the keys to Saint Peter? Before Perugino could offer his verdict, two ladies stepped up. I'd already met. All right, more than met. The one with eyes the color of a frozen lake. She curtsied and said,
"Signor Raphael Santi, may I present my sister?"
The other shoved a piece of paper at me.
"Per favore, may I have a drawing?"
I shrugged apologetically at Perugino, although I wasn't altogether upset that he had to witness such a request. I took a piece of chalk from my pocket and said to the lady holding the paper, "Behold a deity stronger than I, who shall rule over me." A Dante quote is always appropriate in any situation, don't you find? Keeping my eyes on the lady's face, I haven't needed to look at my hand to draw since I was, what, 10? I sketched her quickly. "The corner of your eye turns quite nicely here," I said, using my bit of chalk to point to her face. "Look closely at my next Madonna, and you may find a touch of yourself in her features."
"Oh."
The young woman blushed the color of an oleander bloom. She took the drawing, and they both scampered back to their friends. With a smile, I turned back to Perugino, whose bulbous nose was flaring. That's when he spit out a single word.
"Thief!"
The other men in his entourage muttered. Tessa gasped. I replied, "Scusi?" Perugino was shorter than I, but his large round head overshadowed mine. He said,
"You stole my painting!"
I willed the hot flush on my neck to cool and descend back down my chest. Knowing how to defend against a blush is an invaluable skill for any courtier. Thank my mother for teaching me how to breathe properly to maintain a creamy complexion. "Maestro, my work is, as always, a tribute to you, your talent, your influence, your..." Perugino wagged his finger.
"That altarpiece is nothing more than a copy of mine."
"Have you seen my Marriage of the Virgin?" "That's all right. It's all the way up in Città di Castello, so it's not as if you'd run across it on a daily jaunt. But you've seen copies. Then you'll know I couldn't deny his charge. Not exactly. Both paintings, his hanging in Perugia's cathedral, depict Mary's marriage to Joseph, a common enough subject. But I also employed the same composition, same setting, and, yes, many of the same figures as Perugino's earlier version. But, ma per carità, Perugino's figures are so static there is no rhythm, and the figures in the foreground are pressed against the picture plane, and the temple in the background is so heavy it weighs down the composition, and his colors are such thin blues and pinks. What was I supposed to do? Allow a painting to remain inferior when I could see so clearly how to improve upon it? I didn't say any of that out loud, of course. Courtiers never speak their own minds, but only the minds of others. Petrarch said that the way artists emulate each other is like bees extracting pollen from flowers to make honey and wax. It's not a matter of copying. It's a matter of taking what's come before and making it better.
Better? Better?
Perugino's face turned the color of cherry sauce on Easter.
I feel sorry for you, Raphael. All you want is to be the greatest, but the greatest will never be a lousy copyist.
Perugino marched out of the church. The other men followed. Tessa took my hands and muttered how sorry she was.
And for you to bring me here, to your altarpiece of Joseph taking the hand of Mary to join for eternity. It's so romantic.
I turned to Tessa. Her brown eyes were wide and glistening. Che? She blushed.
You're not going to make me say it, are you?
Say what?
Rafa!
She sounded stern as a nun on Holy Thursday.
You don't have to be coy. I don't have a father, nor brother or uncle. No family at all. You don't need to ask anyone else.
She tugged plaintively on my fingers.
You're the one who brought me here.
I brought you here to meet my maestro, to see if he liked my painting. Her fingers turned cold.
But you said today would change our lives. You said we were going to create perfection. Then you asked me to accompany you here to San Francesco. I told you this was where I wanted to get married.
Married? I dropped her hands.
Or engaged?
Tessa, whatever gave you the impression I was going to marry you? Pink crept up her chest. She crossed her arms and glared. Uffa. I couldn't exactly argue with my own actions in my studio, in the woods, behind the blacksmith's shop. I began picking a speck of green paint off my thumbnail. I think you're lovely. I braced for screams, but her voice was unnervingly calm when she said,
It's time to stop hiding me behind locked doors and painter's tarps, Raphael Santi.
Mia cara, I'm a painter, not made for marriages and family.
Other painters marry. They keep workshops, assistants, wives, children.
I'm not other painters. I reached into my pocket, took out my father's old long-handled paintbrush, and started twirling it between my fingers.
Men need children to carry on their legacy.
She grabbed my hand to stop my twirling. Children die, I said. This time it was her turn to reply,
Kay?
And even if children live, I started twirling the brush again. Do you know the names of Giotto's parents? Donatello's? Botticelli's? Even if I do great things, will my father's name trip off the tongues of future generations? Maybe if I make enough of a mark, his name will be written down in a book somewhere. But I can't bring him back. My fingers missed a beat, and my paintbrush clattered to the floor. People die. Marriage can't save you. Children can't save you. Love can't save you. Nothing can save you. She smoothed out her skirt.
Your teacher upset you. We'll talk about this tomorrow.
You think Perugino upset me?
He called you a thief.
That was the greatest thing I've ever heard. I was hoping he'd tell me I did a good job or call me maestro. But never did I imagine him admitting that I'd surpassed him.
That's not what happened.
That's exactly what happened. His jealousy is proof that my altarpiece is better than his. And he knows it. I bent down, picked up the brush, and pocketed it. Tessa stared with... What was that? Distress? Horror? Disgust?
Rafa, to people on the outside, you look so perfect. But...
She suddenly looked unmistakably sad.
How are you ever going to create perfection when you're so far from it?
She turned and walked toward the exit, her skirts swishing against the stone floors. I hate it when people are angry with me. I hadn't meant to break her heart. I never mean to break their hearts, but I didn't follow after her. Instead, I sat down, pulled out my sketchbook, and began to copy my own altarpiece. There were so many details that still needed perfecting. The Madonna's head was too small. The priest's feet were awkward and... Uffa! Although the boy in red tights breaking a stick over his knee was good, he was inspired by a figure in Luca Signorelli's panel of the same subject. His weight shifted so far back over his hips that, if he'd been a real boy, he would have toppled over. My painting might have been good enough to beat Perugino, but it wasn't perfect. Not yet. It was time for me to chase after the painters who were even better than Perugino. The Botticellis, Ghirlandaios, Leonardos of the world. It was time for me to find those painters, study them, copy them. Copy them, until I could take what they did and best it too. Until there was no painter above me. Except me. Chapter 3. September, 1504. Florence. Thank the Blessed Mary that sculptor is not a painter. That's what I thought the first time I saw that giant. Have you seen it? Not copies of it, but the actual thing standing guard outside of City Hall. He's overwhelming, isn't he? Is it his size? His glare? All that gleaming, polished whiteness? I approached quickly, hoping it would shrink upon closer inspection, but it only grew taller. Staring up at him that first time, I felt how the shepherd boy must have felt when facing down his own giant. Fearful, anxious, doubtful, and yet flush with faith that I could, somehow, find a way to defeat that undefeatable foe. It's ironic that I felt that way not while staring up at a statue of Goliath, but of David. I hadn't been back to Florence in 7 years. 7 years! Even after the Florentines burned that madman friar at the stake, same as he'd burned their Botticellis, an irony that still gives me no end of joy, and fashioned their city into a modern republic, I'd been too afraid to return. But then, I'd heard a rumor about a new statue unveiled in Florence, that according to travelers along the pilgrimage route, would change art forever. One young woman, ears so pointed she could have been a fairy, told me that it had been made by the same sculptor who'd carved his name into his Roman Pietà. No matter what he says now, no one knew his name back then, even though we'd all heard of his Pietà, a marble masterpiece of the Virgin Mary cradling the crucified Christ. I hadn't been to Rome, so I hadn't seen it yet, but that sculptor was already my hero. According to rumors, he'd carved his name into the strap crossing the Madonna's chest, Such and such from Florence carved this. Who had ever heard of such arrogance, such boasting, such brilliance? Che grande! Yes, even at the time, I recognized the irony that although we'd heard about the act of signing his work, we couldn't remember his name. But still, I'd followed his lead and painted my own name onto my Marriage of the Virgin altarpiece too. On the cornice of the temple in the background, Raphael Urbinas, 1503. Where am I in the story again? Ah, yes. Not even the ghosts of Florence could keep me from seeing that sculptor's new statue. As I neared the city, the cathedral's terracotta dome crested over the horizon first. It was late in the day, so the sky was turning warm golden pink. If you want to make such a color, grind up the dried bodies of female kermes insects, add a bit of white lead and a touch of yellow, ochre over orpiment, and a thin layer of gold leaf over the top. The Arno River reflected the pink-orange sky and distant violet mountains. No wonder art had grown back so quickly after that madman friar's execution. The city looked perfect as any painting I could imagine. When I entered Piazza della Signoria, the same square where that bonfire had once burned, I once again faced a towering foe. I counted my steps as I approached. At least this time the foe was only a statue. Marble carving and painting are different, aren't they? Whereas statues naturally have weight, they're physical, in-the-round things. Paintings must rely on tricks of the eye to achieve such weight and realism. Painters and sculptors don't practice the same art. No. Let him be the greatest marble carver in history. I could still be the greatest painter. And thank Madonna, because as I walked around that statue, I wondered how could anyone make even a back feel so alive. When I was young, I used to have to sit for hours at interminable court dinners. The Duke would wave out course after course of rich food that made me sleepy, and Jester Dominic would tell a story or there would be dancing. I was too young to join in, and I would have to sit next to my mother and wait for my father to wheel out his paintings and read his poetry. I adore my father, but his poems were long. My mother would grab my twitching fingers and hold them still with a scolding look. Whatever I felt was to be sealed in a jar and not even used in my paintings. I had no idea whether that sculptor had ever been taught to cloak his emotions in courtly manners, but I did know that he had put all of his energy, his passion, his whatever it was, into that stone. And that's the moment when I decided to settle in Florence, so I too could learn to bend the world, not in the sculptor's direction, but in mine. But as I sat there copying that statue, I couldn't help but silently repeat, "Thank the Blessed Virgin Mary, that sculptor is not a painter." Chapter 4. Autumn, 1504.
How dare they commission a lowly stonecutter for such an important painting?
Bellowed Davide Ghirlandaio as he barged into the tavern. Ghirlandaio was the most foul-tempered painter in all of Florence. Don't blame him. How nice would you be if, after your brother had been dead for 10 years, you were still considered the inferior painter of the two? Andrea del Sarto, 3 years younger than I, with cheeks so angular and nose so long that his face looks like a masquerade mask, and I grabbed 3 more chairs and cups of ale for Ghirlandaio and the other two artists quick on his heels. Andrea della Robbia, I admire Andrea's blue and white terracottas almost as much as I admire his style. That day he was wearing a purple feathered hat that only Andrea could pull off without provoking laughter. and Leonardo da Vinci. Leonardo was one of the first artists I befriended upon entering Florence. He has a soft spot for handsome young men, so he invited me to his studio to copy whenever I wanted. I'm sorry you never met him. Like his paintings, he's hard to picture without seeing in person. Back then, he was over 50 with a graying beard. I predicted correctly that he'd have a full head of silver before another year was out. He was taller than you'd think, and his golden eyes always pranced around, making you feel like you were missing out on 6,000 things happening right in front of you. Dropping into the chair next to me, he said,
"If I'm not upset about the damned fresco, Davide, you have no right to be."
I tucked my hair behind both ears and asked, "What's going on?" No one spoke as we waited for Leonardo to take a long, slow drink. No one ever spoke when waiting on the maestro. He ran his tongue along his teeth and finally responded,
"The city has hired someone else to paint the wall opposite mine inside the hall of the Great Council."
For about a year, Leonardo had been working on his large-scale fresco, the Battle of Anghiari, a depiction of a Florentine military victory over the Milanese. Even in a city home to many of the greatest works of art in history, people hummed with the promise of such a masterpiece from such a master. Imagine the pilgrims it will attract. Imagine the fame. Imagine the glory. I'd never considered that the city would hire a different artist to compete with Leonardo on the opposite wall in the same room. And I'd certainly never considered what Leonardo said next.
"To paint that wall, the city has hired Michelangelo."
I sat back hard in my chair. I'd learned the sculptor's name soon after settling in Florence. After the David, everyone was talking about him. Michelangelo Buonarroti was the son of a proud Florentine family that had fallen on hard times, and it was now up to Michelangelo to support his destitute father, stepmother, grandmother, uncle, aunt, and 4 gadabout brothers. If the city had offered him a lucrative painting commission, he no doubt would take it. The sculptor was to become a painter after all. I took out my father's old paintbrush and began to twirl. Andrea della Robbia took off his hat and said,
"His fresco is to be the same size as Leonardo's, in the same room."
"They're comparing that lowly stone cutter to Leonardo."
Ghirlandaio banged his fist against the table, rattling cups. I adjusted mine so that the handle was once again aligned to the table's edge.
"The only reason you're not upset about it, Leonardo, is that the city is touting it as a competition between the 2 greatest living artists."
Sarto, always one for theatrics, hopped up onto the table and exclaimed,
"Leonardo on one wall, Michelangelo on the other. Who will prevail?"
"I don't mind that promotional campaign," quipped Leonardo.
Ghirlandaio shook his head.
"I can't believe you're consenting to share your workspace with that dirty, dusty,
lowly stonecutter."
We called in unison and raised our cups to drink to that insult. But Ghirlandaio held up a hand.
"Filthy stonecutter!"
We groaned and lowered our cups.
"You're only jealous because your brother gets all the credit for Michelangelo's success," said Sarto, sitting back down.
"Your brother?" I asked. "Who? Domenico?" Ghirlandaio squeezed the bridge of his nose.
"Michelangelo's maestro for a time."
I pressed my lips to avoid gaping. Was there a more skilled frescoist of his generation than Davide's older brother, Domenico Ghirlandaio? Michelangelo wasn't only trained as a sculptor, but as a painter. Ghirlandaio flicked his fingers under his chin in an obscene gesture.
The only thing my brother should get credit for is turning his famed student into a misanthropic recluse.
Sarto shook his head.
You make him sound a little coarse.
In that case, allow me to make my meaning clear. He's extraordinarily coarse.
As an aside to me, Ghirlandaio added,
he built a privacy shed so that no one could see his progress on his David until it was publicly unveiled. Once, when he caught me sneaking a peek at his work, he chased me out of his studio with a marble hammer. Then he locked himself back inside with his precious stone like a deranged hermit. He's an aggressive sort of paranoid.
He's impressive is what he is,
said Sarto, looking at me with earnest eyes.
Michelangelo was trained in the Medici sculpture garden, taken in by Lorenzo de' Medici, Il Magnifico himself, Light of Florence, greatest patron our city has ever seen, finest eye on the peninsula, most educated, most intelligent, most perceptive.
On with it, Sarto. We all know who Il Magnifico is,
Ghirlandaio grumbled.
The point is, Il Magnifico himself recognized Michelangelo's talent and took him in to live in the Medici Palace like one of his sons.
All this according to Buonarroti,
grumbled Ghirlandaio.
It's not only according to Michelangelo,
argued Sarto.
I heard one of Il Magnifico's own sons, Cardinal Giovanni de' Medici himself, once call Michelangelo brother.
When did you meet Cardinal de' Medici?
Countered Andrea.
I don't care about the Medici.
Ghirlandaio got up to pace.
Stone cutters are nothing but craftsmen. They use heavy tools to beat into rock. They're nothing like painters. Donatello, arguably the greatest sculptor in history, didn't also claim to be a master painter. Nanni di Banco, Della Quercia, Nicola Pisano. None of them painted.
What about Verrocchio? I chimed in. His Baptism of Christ, Tobias and the Angel.
Tell me you aren't suggesting that Michelangelo is another Verrocchio,
he said, and I lowered my eyes to avoid an argument.
Not even Ghiberti,
Ghirlandaio went on,
whose baptistry doors have so much grace that they themselves look like masterful paintings, painted anything worth quoting. That job should never go to a lowly stonecutter.
On those final two words, we clinked cups and drank, but none of us were laughing. Michelangelo was picking up our weapons and marching into our arena. And yet, the uncomfortable truth was, we had no idea how good of a painter he would be. Imagine if Michelangelo managed to keep another David secret. Imagine if this time, the David was in paint. I put down my cup and asked, so, who are Michelangelo's friends? The others exchanged looks. Andrea was the one who replied,
he doesn't have any.
Then how are we supposed to get into his studio to copy his work?
We don't,
they all answered in unison. We have to find a way to see his designs. I straightened my cup. Don't we? Ghirlandaio slumped back into his chair.
Raphael's right. We need to find out if Michelangelo has any chance of catching us.
And with his inscrutable half-smile, Leonardo added,
or if we have any chance of catching him.
Chapter 5, 1505. For your lips, cinnabar. For your eyes, finely ground umber. And for your skin, I paused to kiss her collarbone. Gypsum, but with a hint of pinked carmine. The lady was my favorite model of late. What was her name again? I don't remember. Let's call her Sophia. I liked a Sophia once. I'd been using this Sophia,
as the model for the Madonna in my newest altarpiece for the Ansidei family. She had a lovely long face and high forehead that made for a wonderfully believable virgin. In paint, at least. She touched a strand of my hair.
Do you use saffron or sulfur to lighten your locks?
Neither. It's all natural, I said, and leaned in to kiss her again. But she pushed her hand against my face.
Do you hear voices?
Only the voice of the poet Catullus imploring us to let live, let love, my lady.
Listen.
She closed up her blouse. Two voices echoed down the hallway. Footsteps approached. Had I remembered to lock the door? I'd locked it yesterday. And last week. 2 weeks ago I'd forgotten, but no one had come in. This time, let's see. I'd entered first and held the door. When Sophia passed, she'd smelled of fresh peaches. Yes. Yes, I definitely locked it. I'd cursed myself for wasting time locking that door. Calmati. The door is... A key slid into the lock. Andiamo. I yanked the tarp down over the scaffolding and pulled her to the back wall. If we were discovered, my reputation would survive, but Sophia's prospects for a good marriage would drop faster than a jar of red lead off a high shelf. I smoothed down my vest. It would be all right. As long as whoever entered didn't want to look at the fresco, we were well hidden. I winced. Why would anyone come into that room unless they wanted to look at that fresco? We were in the great salone of the Palazzo della Signoria, where Leonardo's Battle of Anghiari fresco was going up on one wall. Have you ever been inside Florence's great hall? It's monumental. Ceilings 2 stories tall with light coming in through high windows. It feels like a cathedral, which is appropriate considering the Florentines hold their civic duties as dear as their spiritual ones. At the time, the most prominent features of that great hall were Leonardo's spread of scaffolding and his preparatory drawings rolled out across the floor. His designs for that fresco were extraordinary. Soldiers and horses swirling in the chaos of war. The Battle of Anghiari had been a great victory for the Florentines. But instead of depicting the glory, Leonardo captured the violence and fear. It was extraordinary, and every Florentine was eager for a preview. So yes, I gallantly gave my models a private tour of the famous fresco whenever they asked. Leonardo was always happy to take a walk in the hills during such visitations. No wonder he finished so few projects. He was always looking for any excuse not to work. On that day, 2 voices, neither belonging to Leonardo, entered the room. I'll pay whatever you want.
It's not about the money. You're asking me to expose my soul.
2 men, both with Tuscan accents. I didn't recognize either.
So? That's what artists do.
Artists? I signaled for Sophia to stay back while I peeked through a slit in the tarp. I could only see the back of one of their heads.
I'm not asking to inspect it as a city official, but to see it as a friend, Michelangelo.
Michelangelo? I'd never been in the same room with the sculptor before. Ignoring the advice of Sarto and Ghirlandaio, the day I start listening to Sarto is the day I pick out my own sarcophagus. I stopped by Michelangelo's studio several times to try to cajole him into letting me study his designs, but he wasn't one to invite people in for soup. Once I approached him in the market, waving a few drawings Leonardo had lent to me. You can study the competition, I tempted. But Michelangelo glared and said he didn't want anything to do with the cavolo who stole from Perugino. Although I found it encouraging that he'd heard of me, I'd made no progress towards seeing his designs. I shifted behind the tarp to get a better look. The second man was wearing a blue cape with gold stars. the cape belonging to the head of Florence's republican government, Gonfaloniere Piero Soderini. Have you met him? Bald, round eyes. Picture a pigeon in a cape.
You don't understand what you're asking.
Michelangelo sounded like a wounded boy. And Soderini replied, I know you didn't bring that cartoon down here for nothing. I clasped my hand over my mouth to keep from gasping out loud.
His cartoon was here.
I dropped down silently to the floor, lay on my stomach, and slid forward to peek under the tarp. There were Michelangelo's shoes, heavy brown work boots covered in mud and marble dust. And sure enough, down by his side was a long roll of paper.
Queen of Heaven. His designs.
Soderini dropped his voice to a paternal tone.
Son, we're alone. You can trust me.
There was more back and forth, but Michelangelo's quarreling always gets a little tedious, doesn't it? So let's skip to when he finally relented and started unrolling his designs. He handled his drawing as carefully as if it were thin gold leaf, and Soderini watched the cartoon unfold as intently as I. Sophia whispered,
Die. They aren't looking. Die, die.
I waved her off. Soderini looked down at the unfurled drawing and murmured,
Miraculous.
From my position on the floor, I couldn't even see one line of that drawing, so I hopped up and quickly climbed the scaffolding.
Don't roll it up, don't roll it up, don't roll it up.
Sophia grabbed my foot, but I kicked off her hand. The wood creaked, but I kept going. The top of the scaffolding wasn't covered by a tarp, so I had to lie flat to look over the edge. At first, I could only see one corner of the drawing, done in brown chalk and black ink. Bulging calf, grasping hand, twisted knee. Was the figure naked? Was he pushing himself up off the ground? Another naked man was bending over. A third lunged. What was going on? I lifted up onto my elbows.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.